محمد و آل محمد صلوات.
اللهم صل على محمد و آل محمد.
Ensures that he has at home the kind of car, the kind of things should be beneficial to him. This is known as jalbul manfa'a, according to the kalam of the ulama. This is known as jalbul manfa'a, to attract what is beneficial. And the second innate inclination is daf' ad-darar. That means to repel what is harmful. And that's why you will find that if, for example, the person sees that, you know, this is the season when the mosquitoes come and malaria can be gotten, so what he'll do, he'll make sure that he has a mosquito net. For example, he knows that if I pass through this road, there are bugs that are going to come, there are thieves that are going to attack, so he'll not pass through this road, he'll pass through another road. Why? Because it is natural in him, daf' ad-darar. These are two innate things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has kept in the human being. Now when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Al-haqum al-takathur. Al-takathur means to overcome one another in multiplying and increasing the worldly possessions. This has hampered and occupied you, all human beings, from what? From what is beneficial to you and what is detrimental for you. So you don't think about these things. What you do is you completely continue competing with each other and seeing that how many do I have? He has 40, I must have 50. If he, for example, can afford that kind of suit, I can afford a better kind of suit, and so on. And sometimes, you know, some faint marks of such a phenomenon goes, you know, really transpires in our communities. For example, we find that, of course, in some of the jamaats or some of the communities, this is reported, that if, for example, a lady comes with a new cloth, the other lady will say, oh, I don't have a new cloth, so I cannot go to the mosque. With what face will I go to the mosque? And this is happening. A group of women would come with new dresses at every occasion, new occasion. So the others will say, those people, of course, who are competing. Those who are not competing and know, they have salamatul fitra, their innate nature is salim and protected. They will say, whatever happens, I will come and, you know, wear a decent dress. Yes, I have, for example, two pairs or three pairs or four pairs, whatever it is, and I know when to wear them and so on, and I don't care about the others. That's something else. These people have maintained themselves. But there's some people, no, al-haqum al-takathur, they would like to compete. They say, no, this one is worn this. Next time when the, for example, miladat of the Prophet comes, I'm going to wear better. And may I make sure that I also wear these ornaments, for example. She did not wear that kind of ornaments. I would like to look more beautiful and so on. This is known as takathur. And then takathur also is in various forms. Sometimes, you know, you'll be surprised, but takathur is also within the ulama. Why? You'll see him buying books and books and books and books, not reading them, obviously. Sometimes you read. You buy books and read, understand, communicate and all that, that's all right. But sometimes you find the person buying books and books, oh, this person has a library which is two rooms, I must have three rooms. So that I am considered superior, for example. This is known as takathur. And that is why you will find that usually some of the ulama also don't, when they welcome you, they will welcome you in a room where there is no book also. So that they don't even show you that they have even one book. Because this is not the criteria of judging a person. So takathur can be in different planes of existence. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the next verse says, see, this takathur will go on. Al-haqum al-takathur hatta zurtum al-maqabir. Until you visit the graves. Now, when we talk about visiting the grave, what do we mean here? Here, the Mufassirin have given different interpretations, and all these interpretations can be taken to be true. See, the Holy Quran is wasi'. It's not that, you know, we have to limit to one meaning. Sometimes you will find that apparently we have seven meanings. or 70 meanings according to one tradition, for example. وَلِذَهْرِهِ ظَهْرٌ. Not only وَلِذَهْرِهِ بَطْن, not only the apparent has a hidden, but for that apparent, there is another apparent. The way one of the ulama, just this sentence, وَعَلَمُوا أَنَّ فِيكُمْ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ. Mind you, that among you, the messenger of Allah is there. وَعَلَمُوا أَنَّ فِيكُمْ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ. This ayah, this small ayah, he did for 30 days continuously, different tafsir every day. He would come in one of the mosques of Qom, and one day he would do one tafsir. The second day he would do another tafsir, which would not be contrary to that, no, but would be another apparent probability of that tafsir. And therefore, you know, the Holy Quran is powerful if you go and see when it comes to tafsir. Now, one of the tafsir is that حتى زرتم المقابر means حتى دخلتم ودفنتم في القبور. That means until you die. زرتم means until you visit المقابر. المقابر are graves. So until you die, this is what it means. And many of the Mufassirin have said this. So see, let us look at it logically. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that, you know, this tafasul, this showing off, this competition will go on only for a certain duration, maybe 40 years, 50 years, 60 years, then it will stop. It's not eternal. In the grave, it's not going to benefit you. Hatta zurtum al-maqabir. Yes, if you had something that you would do tafasul and you would boast that, for example, I have taqwa. And of course, a person who has taqwa would never boast. But let's say, if a person says, I would like to increase and increase my taqwa, then حَتَّى زُرْتُمُ الْمَقَابِرُ is not there for him. Even when he goes to the qabr, he enjoys the same thing, and he will continue enjoying. Why? Because this is not something which is temporary, and which is, for example, superficial. But here, when we talk about tatathur, all this is superficial. Today you see, the more beautiful thing is that those rich people who are affluent and they have become old, just look at them and talk to them and study their life, and you will find that subhanAllah, really, this old man, obviously I'm talking about those old men who wasted their lifetime in just earning and not thinking about the hereafter. When you look at their life, you see that you are better off. Even in your form of poverty, you are 100 times better than what he is facing. He has not brought anything with him. He is near the grave. So it is important for us to try to understand that, you know, this tafakhur and tadabbur and showing off and boasting and trying to multiply takathur hatta zurtumul maqabir until you die. That's all. It's not going to continue. It's not that thing that is that of the spirit that will enable you to continue throughout and forever. Another meaning of hatta zurtum al-maqabir, which is also interesting, and some of our ulama, Shia ulama, have mentioned, is hatta zurtum al-maqabir means until you go to the graveyards and see the graves and try to think that yesterday they were with us, today they are not with us. What happened to them? Last year he was there, today he is not there. He was a rich person. Where is his wealth? It's been spent by his sons, or by his, which has been already inherited by different people of his family. He's not using even a cent now. Rather, he is extremely needy of the people around him. That's how his station is. This is another meaning of hatta zurtum al-maqabir. Another beautiful interpretation and probability of hatta zurtum al-maqabir is usually the time of the Holy Prophet, there are some people. Who funny in character. Because, you know, when they would do takathur and they would try to brag and boast about their number, for example, see, I've got 5 houses and 6 properties, I've got 4 wives and 20 children, and so on, they would continue till they would come to the graveyard and see, look at those people who have been buried, more are my relatives, not yours. Hatta zurtumul maqabir. There were people like that. This is another interpretation. That, you know, these people, look at these people. You, of course, it is addressing to those people who do takathur. Alhaakumul takathur. Hatta zurtumul maqabir. Don't you have shame? Even you want to even brag about those people who are buried in the graves? Kalla sawfa ta'lam. No. Surely you will know. Kalla sawfa ta'lam. The word sawfa in Arabic, the word sawfa and seen only. For example, if I tell you sawfa ta'lam or sata'lam, both of them show that something will happen very close, very soon. So, kalla sawfa ta'lamun. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that surely you will soon know what will transpire because of what has diverted you from what is important. You know, when we mentioned that innate, the human nature's nature is such that he repels what is harmful for him and attracts what is beneficial. This is the same as Tawalla and Tabarra. Look at the gist of Tawalla and Tabarra. Tabarra means you are going away from those things which are bad and evil. And Tawalla, because the word Tawalla and Tabarra, even etymologically, that is literally, means that Tabarra means you are going aloof, al-ibti'ad. And Tawalla means that you are going near, that is al-iqtirab. So Tawalla and Tabarra are as if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is trying to say that, you know, that you have been created for Tawalla and Tabarra, to get close to me and to be away from shaitan. But al-haakum al-takathur. But these things, these belongings of life, instead of considering them to be a means for a higher end, you have taken it as, you know, things to brag about. See, I have this much. And sometimes it becomes a disease. You know, the problem with us is we don't realize. A time comes that we cannot go away from that, because we have already come to a station whereby we are competing and we are winning and we are enjoying. And if we lose, then the other person will really hit us hard near other people. So it is, it's a very a strange kind of life. But those people who do it, you know best how it is. And it's happening, as I told you, it's happening in certain levels in our communities. It's happening even in other communities. I'm not just saying that it's in our community, but we know of some instances whereby you find that, for example, a certain lady will say, I will not go to the mosque because everybody will say, this one is a poor person, she can't afford, and therefore I will not go because I don't have a new dress. For every occasion you buy a new dress, for example. This is why, because the person feels awkward. The whole environment is like that, of tafakkur, you know. Anyway, so hatta zurtumul maqabir kalla sawfa ta'lamun. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that indeed you shall know very soon. Then Allah continues and says, thumma kalla sawfa ta'lamun. Verily you shall know very soon. What you shall know? That what you are doing was wrong. And what awaits you is not something easy. This is what it is. But here, ulama have said, there are two probabilities. One probability is that the reason of repeating this kalla sawfa ta'lamun, thumma kalla sawfa ta'lamun, is emphasis. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is trying to emphasize. Other ulama, they also refer to a very beautiful riwayah. They say that the first kalla sawfa ta'lamun refers to what you will know in the grave when you go to Barzakh. But thumma kalla sawfa ta'lamun refers to after the Qiyamah al-Sughra is finished in Barzakh, when you will be resurrected at the Qiyamah al-Kubra. That is when you shall really know what's going to happen. Now this is something that those people who have already purified themselves in this world, they do attain, they see all these things. And therefore for them, they can understand what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is trying to say. But because this has been addressed to those people who like to increase their commodities and, you know, overcome each other, it's a mutual fight, and it's a continual mutual fight which goes on throughout a person's life, and he's ghafil, and suddenly hatta zurtumul maqabir, and therefore such a person would not perceive it because of his black heart, because it has enveloped him and engaged him from things which are more important in his life, right? That is to, for example, cleanse his soul and take out all the specks of kibr that he has. You know, you'll be surprised in that beautiful khutbah of Bibi Fatima Zahra alayhi salam, when she tries to enumerate the philosophy of ibadat. The khutbah is known as khutbah fadakiyya, khutbah fadak, after her rights are usurped, and she comes in the mosque and says and fights for her rights. In that khutbah, she mentions the philosophy of each ibadah. In one of the places, she mentions that the philosophy of salat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made salat so that it eradicates kibr. Even a speck of kibr. You know, you find some people, you write to them, Salam alaykum, with very beautiful, in a very beautiful approach. But they also don't want to write alaykum salam. Leave alone alaykum salam. Sometimes they would just say salam, something like that. You say salam alaykum wa rahmatullah, it is wajib for the person to say wa alaykum salam wa rahmatullah, or add wa barakatuh, because he should reply the same way or better, as the Quran says. But you find that kibr and that pride does not allow him, although he's a Muslim. That means he's not praying. Because here Bibi Fatima Zahra alayhi salam clearly says that وَجَعَلَ salat, so that kibr is completely eradicated. But if he has specks of kibr, then you know that his salat is not a salat, it's just a formal kind of phenomenon that is transpiring. Alright? So ثُمَّ كَلَّا سَوْفَ تَعْلَمُونَ كَلَّا لَوْ تَعْلَمُونَ عِلْمًا يَقِينًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, كَلَّا لَوْ تَعْلَمُونَ عِلْمًا يَقِينًا. Nay, were you to know the knowledge of conviction, that means were you to know with conviction of the heart. Here, there are two probabilities, but I would like to tell you what Allama Tabatabai in Al-Mizan is saying, because he's one of the very powerful scholars of Tafsir. He says, كَلَّا لَهُ تَعْلَمُونَ عِلْمَ الْيَقِينَ refers to the knowledge of the heart. كَلَّا لَهُ تَعْلَمُونَ عِلْمَ الْيَقِينَ. This sentence doesn't continue with لَتَرَوُونَ الْجَحِيمَ. لَتَرَوُونَ الْجَحِيمَ, there is something elliptical between this sentence and لَتَرَوُونَ الْجَحِيمَ. And that thing which is hidden and elliptical is that لَوْ تَعْلَمُونَ عِلْمَ الْيَقِينَ, if you would know the knowledge of conviction, you would have seen the results of what you did throughout your life. And then لَتَرَوُنَّ الْجَحِيمَ, and surely you would have seen hellfire. Now here, seen hellfire, some of the Mufassirin say that, you know, this is something which refers to the Qiyamah, but Allama Tabatabai says no, it doesn't refer to Qiyamah. Rather, it refers to this world, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is still talking about this world.
كلا لو تعلمون علم اليقين لترون الجحيم